great to see a lot of familiar faces. I think we're getting more and more familiar faces every time we have this. Just a quick show of hands, who's new at ProductTank? Who's like coming here for the first time? Okay, still about 50% of the guys. All right, awesome. So I'm going to quickly just tell you guys a little bit about ProductTank. So we started in 2010 in London, and as all good, great ideas start, they were started over drinks where a bunch of product managers just said, we need to do something for the community. So that's basically how ProductTank started. In 6 years, it's now in over 100 cities with over 30,000 members, and we'll tell you how you can take be involved in the community. So the community basically has meetups, we have a Slack channel where there are a lot of people who will help you out with any product management issues that you do have or if you want to get introduced to people, so you can join that. There's a Mind the Product blog, and we do have conferences as well. So if you want to join the Slack channel, that's it. If you want to write for the blog, write out to the editor. And we also do have a weekly newsletter, which is pretty cool. You can sign up for that. And we do have jobs available on the site as well. And we have a community, so if you guys are hiring, you can post up your jobs up there. Finally, once in a while, we do have product conferences. The last one was in London a few months ago, and we will know about the next one shortly. If you guys want to join us for Singapore, that's your link, bit.ly/ProductTank. It takes you to the Facebook page, which is where we have a community and we announce all our events. That brings us on to tonight. We're actually going to be having a panel discussion. This is the first time we're trying out this new format. Hopefully it should be very interesting. And it actually started off because there was a conversation going on about Agile a couple of months ago, which ended up having a lot of very diverse views. And that's me saying it at my diplomatic best.
So, there was no blood on the floor.
Yeah, there was no blood on the floor. So we have a pretty good panel today. We're going to be talking about Agile software development, and because there are a lot of different companies in Singapore which either use it, don't use it, they just dismiss it because it's too complicated or they just don't know how. So we're going to be speaking about that. And the panelists are going to be Jordan, he's right here. And do you want to take a spot, Jordan? We're going to be sitting right up front.
Okay.
Jordan's the VP of Engineering at TradeGecko, and Jordan's been working in tech since before most of us in this room learned, were born actually. He wrote a book before we were born.
Laid down my first line of code in 1981.
He's worked in Apple, he's worked at Yahoo, he's currently at TradeGecko, and he's got some great stories, so you guys got to catch up with him after that. We also have Nuno, who is a veteran. He's in the fintech field, and he used to work with Standard Chartered, a bank, and he was telling me earlier on about how he is, they rolled out Dash together when it was still awesome, when Dash was awesome.
Oh, sorry.
So presently, Nuno is at PocketMath. And finally, we got Varun. Varun is with Lazada right now. And Varun is also partially the reason why we had to reduce everyone's pictures, because his designation was very long. jokes aside, Varun has actually worked with Lockheed Martin in the past, which I thought was incredibly cool. No, Nuno has worked with Lockheed Martin. Sorry. Okay.
I didn't know you did that too.
You should have flown a plane to
Nuno has worked with Lockheed Martin, and Varun has done a lot of payment systems, and he's presently at Lazada, all right? So that's our panel. I'm Uttam from Yahoo, and I'm going to be the panelist where we're going to ask questions. So the way we're going to go about this is we have a few questions that we're going to be asking the panelists about, after which we'll open it up to a lot of Q&A from you guys, which we certainly hope there will be a lot of. Okay, so...
They're wrong. They're just muted.
Oh, sorry.
Less number of people. Do we need a mic today? Can the last row hear it now?
Let's just keep a mic.
I think he wants to record. They want to record it.
Anyway, Jordan doesn't need a mic. It's fine.
Yeah, Jordan doesn't need a mic. Okay, so I'm going to start off with Varun, okay? Because once it gets to Jordan, it normally...
stays with him.
No, because once it gets to Jordan, then people will be slightly quieter. So we're going to end with Jordan, all right. So Varun, in your view, how would you describe the state of Agile in Singapore? What do you think is going on overall out here? And especially focusing on Singaporean startups, not like the MNC companies out here, which pretty much all of them will practice Agile. What are your thoughts on that?
So in my experience, I personally feel in Singaporean startup scene, they hear a lot about what Agile is, and there are building blocks required for actually running a real Agile organization. So you need developers with certain skill set, you need a level of motivation, this specific requirements. So the traditional developers are like, these are developers, these are Java developers, this is QA. That was the old structure in Singapore. So a lot of talent hasn't matured to the level that they can handle the way Agile works. And just because it's cool, it's funky, it's fashionable, every startup wants to deploy it. And that delta causes a scenario where neither can they get the best of either world. Neither can they do Agile properly, neither can they do waterfall properly, and they're stuck in the middle of both. And that's a challenge. So that was the whole way where the conversation started, that challenge which we have.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, Nuno, how about you? Any thoughts
on that? I don't know if I can speak so much to how I see the situation in startups in Singapore, because my experience is fairly limited. I've worked in two, including the one that I'm working on now. And you know, when you hear Varun talk, and I was thinking about what I was gonna say, I'm probably gonna say something very similar to that, because the experience I've had with startups has been that most people don't know how to kickstart the process of implementing any kind of agility. And so they follow the cargo cult, they drink the Kool-Aid, but they don't really know what's behind it. And that's been typically the problem that I've seen. I've seen it once at Fusion Garage, which was one of the startups I worked with. And at PocketMath, we're still sort of trying to figure it out as we grow from an early stage startup to a larger startup. Things get complicated very quickly. Now, what I have seen, though, is in larger companies, so I know this is supposed to be focused maybe on startups, but for MNCs, ironically, I've seen better response. And I believe that part of that was because those companies, with the right environment, which is, you know, a big if, actually have the necessary discipline and, let's call it, management overhead, you know, at the beginning, at least, to get things going. And implement the processes the right way, and then start learning from them. What I do know, though, is as an Agile proponent in the country, ever since I started, so I started around 2008, it's been growing fast, really, really, really fast. It went from you can't find a person to teach you Scrum to you can't kick a rock and not hit somebody who wants to teach you Scrum. So, yeah, well, some of them are really, really good. I'm not sure. I haven't tried them all, but I've tried a couple, and at least those were really, really good. So I guess what that means is that this is getting a lot of traction, and people are at least observing some value of it, even if it is just from the fad of it. And if at the end of all of this, when it's all said and done, if at least some of it has caught on and has become mainstream and you know, taught people a better way to work, I think then it would have been worth it.
So I'm going to talk on kind of three levels here. One is, actually, I'm going to speak globally, and then I'm going to speak in Singapore, and then I'm going to talk about the startups. So first off, I'm going to make a very strong statement here. I don't think less than 10% of people who say they do Agile worldwide actually do Agile. I think one of the big issues is that people don't understand why to do Agile. I'm a big proponent of first principles and understanding first principles. And one of the things that Agile is rooted in is an understanding about the nature of software development. That software development is an empirical process. But what does that really mean? Do people really understand what that means in their gut? And you mentioned cargo cult. You know, if you haven't read Richard Feynman's cargo cult science paper, you should read it. It was a graduation address at Caltech a number of years ago. And what we see is a lot of people who are taking on the forms. And they say, oh, well, we do, I've gone to the places, oh, we do Agile. And I like walk in and I go, and I watch them, and they get up and do a 20-minute stand-up with five people in the group. and there's no board, there's, you know, tracking of issues, there's, you know, I mean, just, you know, it's all these things that just aren't there. And so, first of all, I think less than 10% worldwide are doing it. I think that your balance on the MNCs is correct. I think that the trouble is most of the startups in Singapore don't have experienced staff. They don't have people who've done this before, by and large. I'm making a statement there. And so they don't understand why they just know that waterfall's bad and they shouldn't do waterfall, but they've never experienced the pain of waterfall. They've never been in a project that went 25 months over schedule. That was on a 6-month schedule. Okay? They've never been in something that was supposed to take 6 months and took 30 months. And so they don't know the pain. They don't understand why they should do this. They understand that all the cool kids do agile, and so they do this thing called a stand-up, so we'll do a stand-up. You know, and that's the problem. Go back to first principles. Understand why you're doing it.
Okay, so I'm just gonna get to the audience right here. Just out of curiosity, how many people in this room actually practice agile?
So 10% of you practice agile.
10% of 10%.
So one of you.
So just a few people here, but are there teams in this room who are thinking of an agile, like overall, or not even considering it?
Wow.
Okay.
Are we in the right place?
So coming back.
Sorry, can I just ask Jordan, you've made a rather assertive statement there by first principles. The question then I'm asking would be, what do you think agile is there for then?
What are you?
As a software engineering practice, or?
Well, first off, I think agile is an appropriate methodology for any empirical process, okay? Which might include pharmaceutical discovery, is an empirical process. So I would say, first off, you know, I think it's understand the nature of processes, understand what defined process is, define what empirical process is. And then understand, and then that gets you down into kind of operations research things. And that gets you down to the fact of an empirical process lives and dies on feedback loops and how fast and how quick those feedback loops work. This kind of just gets you, you know, you walk through it and then you start understanding why this makes sense and why you would do it. And then you understand how that maps into the practices. Okay? And, you know, that's what you're gonna be doing there. So, does that answer your question?
Kind of.
So, you know, coming back to what Nuno and Vern had earlier said, you said that one of the issues is that people, that startups out there don't know how to do agile. So what do you think are some of like their biggest blockers out there? Is it knowledge? Is it because they don't have the people in there? Is it just they don't have a need for it?
Convincing that it needs investment to the CFO.
Okay.
Because you pay peanuts, you get monkeys. And with monkeys, you run circuses, you don't win battles with monkeys. Okay. And unfortunately, the fact is if the people who actually do understand how to do it, they would command a price premium. And that's the bottom line, it's a fact. It will command a price premium. And to explain to the finance guy or the CEO who has to sign the check, and if unfortunately that guy has not come from a technology background or who hasn't seen that pain of waterfall before, to explain him why this person should be paid 40% extra or 30%, because that person will be commanding that number because he has that skill set. And to get a buy-in from your own team to do that investment and to accept that it will slightly take longer to set up the team. And this is a different approach. To get that buy-in is tough.
Okay. Your thoughts, similar?
No, not quite. Well, if I try to put myself in Varun's shoes and maybe with some of the exposure that you've had, I can see how that's an issue. Maybe I've been lucky and I've worked very deeply with technology companies, and so the not understanding of the investment doesn't tend to be a problem, but I think even when the investment is there, you still have a lot of issues. I've worked in more than one place where the investment is there, but there's a mismatch of expectations. Unfortunately, when people start trying to practice any kind of agile methodology, they think it's going to be easy. They think it's all just going to be fine. Yeah, we'll just get together, stand up once a day, and you know, put some post-it cards and move them around. It's all going
to
be no.
Send guys to a 2-day workshop, and magic will happen.
Yeah, no, it's actually the day that I suggested my company to embark on a Scrum transition was the worst day of my life, because I went from being a product manager that does one PRD a year to a guy who has to be churning out user stories every day. And it was a nightmare for me at first. I didn't believe that, couldn't believe that I got myself into it. But that's just for the product guy. For the engineers, it's a little bit different. And then they don't believe that they have to actually consider things like continuous delivery or continuous integration, at least, or automated tests. You know, there's all these things that people just take for granted and don't appreciate. So I think a big part of the problem in any company, not just startups, but any company, startups may be a little bit handicapped because of lack of experience. People, I don't know, maybe investment could be an issue, but it's mostly because they don't understand the level of discipline that it's going to take. And I've, I have to say, when you see a disciplined startup, invest in them because they will be a very good company. But most startups I know of are by definition undisciplined.
You guys said it perfect.
Okay, so I'm just going to add on one last question on my own before we go to the next one. Is there a particular size of operation that you think would require agile? Like, so if a company is at a certain particular stage or the product that they're building really isn't that complicated, maybe it just doesn't need it? So I'm talking more in terms of the benefits of it.
So here's the reality. When you have three guys and a dog in a garage, they're practicing agile, they just don't know it. Okay? They're constantly talking. They're talking to the customer. They're working out the issues. You know, the dog's giving its input. but that's the reality. What happens is then there's this transition that happens where you cross into, you have 16 engineers. And but that's overhead. We didn't used to do it that way. I just talked to him and he'd tell me and we made it happen. It's that point. It's that inflection point. When you're three people, you're doing it. It's when you make that inflection. You still need to do it, but now you have to become thoughtful about it. You have to be intentional. You have to be deliberate, you have to have discipline. I mean, to say, when people say, could we do a stand-up twice a week? does he really have to give us detailed stories with acceptance criteria? Or conversely, do I really have to give you that? Can't you guys just kind of figure out what you're supposed to do? And the thing was, because you went from this working relationship, I was talking to a CEO of a company the other day, and she says, yeah, I just can't understand. We were so much productive when we only had six engineers.
Yeah.
And I'm like, at one level, yes. At one level, no. But that was, the kind of the thing.
Awesome, there. Thank you. So if you guys are tweeting, the hashtag is ProductTankSG. You can tweet about the three engineers and the dog. Monkeys in the circus. All right? Just keep the tweets away. Don't, it's all right.
No, it's people
don't. Yeah. Okay.
And the dog's responsible for continuous delivery.
I thought it was the scrum master.
Could be.
All right. So moving on to the next question, and this is more about waterfall-driven industries and companies. What is the biggest argument to change the minds of the people and persuade them that agile minimizes risk? So if you're, all right, and by the way, guys, if you guys were here a couple of months ago, this is where things get really interesting. So, Varun, your thoughts on waterfall and,
If a guy loves alcohol, all the cigarettes you buy, they have this cigarette smoking is injurious to health. That never dissuaded anyone from smoking. So I personally don't think it's the job. I mean, we need to worry about trying to explain and trying to evangelize. And the problem is that the evangelism also creates problems because the thing is, there are enough people who want to do it, but they don't know how to do it well. Let's focus on them. Let's get them right first. There would always be some non-believers. Let the non-believers be there. There are other more bigger problems to solve. And because, if for some companies, order is more important. So they have a structure and they say, we get it, it's not as productive, but we earn money. That lack of productivity is our source of revenue. If you're an IT outsourcing company and your revenue comes by billing hours, you care about the number of hours. Every time there is a scope creep, you're happy. Every time there's a CR, you're happy.
Yep.
And you want to ensure that stays. So try explaining that to Infosys or TCS. That's their bread and butter.
So just to add on to make sure I'm understanding this clearly for everyone out here, are you just saying that waterfall is for inefficient companies? Because
no, waterfall works in the scenario. So the question is, what are the incentives?
Yeah, like so. If
the incentives are billing hours, so the difference, right?
Yeah.
who is the one executing it? If the execution person is an outsourcing firm, who is going to be paid by number of billing hours, not by the product delivery? So there is consignment delivery and billing hour delivery. If it's, okay, this is the product and we agree that this is gonna cost 1 million and you guys develop it. If that's the case, then that guy has the developing arm has an interest to be productive. But if it is, this is the scope and let's see, and you can raise a CR and all that and this billing hour, then that guy doesn't care. He wants to maximize the billing hours. His KPI is to maximize the billing hours. it's in his interest to not optimize it.
So just to say the question again, it's basically for companies that are and organizations that are focused on waterfall, how can you persuade them onto Agile? And what we hear from Varun is for all companies, it might not even be necessary for them to be on Agile because for some business models, waterfall just works better. Nuno?
I think, you know, so the business model is an interesting one. I was thinking of the situation where I started embarking on becoming an Agile fanboy, which was one where we were working on waterfall, and this was with Lockheed, by the way. So we did enterprise software for logistics, and we were in this habit of releasing software every 12 to 18 months. And there was more than one occasion where we actually released software before the PRD was actually signed off. Anybody? That never happens, right? I mean, of course, it unfortunately happens more often than we'd like to admit. But basically what would happen in that company was people would be fighting amongst themselves, you know, the business units would be fighting amongst themselves about who gets what requirements into the next release, to the extent that the engineers feel held, or the product and engineering team was held hostage. So, okay, well, we're not going to have people just twiddling their thumbs and, you know, while being the cost center, so we'll just keep on doing what we know needs to get done. And, you know, there was more than one occasion where this happened, and it was just untenable. So I came up and I said, hey, you know, we should try this Agile stuff, that particularly Scrum. I hear a lot of good stuff about it. Here's this paper from Pete Diemer and this Yahoo person who said that this works out really well and everybody loves it. And that was actually what it took to convince people that moving to a smaller iterations, something a lot more iterative and, you know, smaller commitments, faster delivery, that is probably going to get us further along the way. And we went from 12 to 18 months to a delivery consistently every 3 months, and we went from sales team saying we put up requirements and we don't get them until 18 months later to, guys, slow down, you're delivering too much, I can't keep up and I can't tell my customers that there's all this new stuff coming up. So I think companies that have these kinds of environments where things happen relatively quickly around them, and there's, you know, maybe there's a lot of infighting, and you need to be flexible in how you approach the production pipeline, then Agile works really well, because that's what it's designed to do. It's designed to be adaptable and be dynamic, and so you can swap some things around. And in the long term, the costs will be more or less the same. You know, last time we had this argument about in the short term, how does that work out? And of course, you can't walk away from things that you've already committed. If you're going to throw that away, that's wastage. There's no way around that. So that's one area where I think Agile will definitely help out, even in very large companies. However, the type of business is important, and the counter argument to what I just said is companies like NASA. You don't hear NASA doing too much of Agile development. In fact, probably NASA is only the only company that actually does waterfall right, because they spend months and years doing requirement studies and figuring stuff out so that, you know, people don't get killed while it's going to space. Well, the difference is, you know, space doesn't change very often, right? The laws of physics don't change very often, so they just have to figure it out in simulations as before they actually build the product and then try to put that poor guy in orbit. So places where there isn't a lot of change in the environment, whether internal or external, don't necessarily need to be Agile. But everywhere else I've seen tends to benefit from an Agile approach.
So first thing I would do is I always tell people, actually go find the original waterfall paper that was funded by ARPA, the Advanced Research Projects Administration, and read the last paragraph of the paper about where waterfall is suitable. It's eye-opening. I'm not going to tell you. Go find it. Read it.
Homework.
It's a exercise for the reader.
Okay, can you repeat the paper, please?
So it's the original paper, 1968, funded by the Advanced Research Projects Administration of the United States government, what was before DARPA, the thing that invented the internet, actually. And it's it was a research paper, software engineering, on the where the term waterfall methodology was coined and talked about the methodology and where it is suitable.
It's not related to Fred Brooks' book.
Fred Brooks quotes it in there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you can find the quote in there. So first off, go read that. Also take a contention here. Actually, NASA does do Agile. They do it in their simulators. No.
Which is the best thing for them to do.
Yeah, right, exactly. Right, exactly. No, they're, exactly. But they're actually doing it. So you know, hardware people with their hardware simulators do Agile. Do you think they just design this thing and throw it in silicon and ship it? No. I almost used a word. Different word. They don't. They simulate it. That's iterative. That is iterations. And it's, why did we build faster and faster hardware simulators? So we could iterate faster and faster. You know, so that's, you know. The other thing is, I will ask someone who says, oh, well, you know, too much risk. And I'm gonna say, okay, when's the last time you put a stake in the ground and said you would be doing something in 24 months, and you were actually doing it in the business world? Can you name it? Companies that have rolling forecasts that change every quarter, well, but they actually change in the middle of the quarter because we do a mid-quarter rework and, you know, everything. I mean, come on, none of these people. I beg you, find me someone who puts a stake in the ground and says 24 months we'll be doing this, who's actually doing it. And then ask them, okay, well, in that case, do you really want what's going to be delivered in 24 months to be baked and decided now? That's the bottom line.
I remember you had raised an example, I think in a previous time, speaking about Microsoft, when Microsoft had actually gone and said that they're going to do this 24 months later. They did deliver that 24 months later, but the rest of the world had moved on.
Yep.
So I remember that example coming up. So coming back to round up the question right here, right, and just to make sure that we got everyone's views properly out here. So does everyone here believe that Agile minimizes risk as opposed to just building it anyway, like waterfall all the way?
Yeah, I do think it minimizes risk for sure. Because
as well?
See, again, depends. So there are scenarios where it creates more risk because, for example, again, when you have your in-house development teams, it's very different versus when you have a mix hybrid or a fully outsourced development team. Mm-hmm. Because the outsourced development team guy needs to hire people, he needs to maintain all of it. So he will ask you for a retainer upfront because we need to agree that my guys are going to be in job for next 2 years because I'm going to train them on the skill set you want. You want them to do Android programming on blah, blah, blah skill set. I'm going to invest this much. So I want a 2-year retainer contract. What these guys will do can be negotiated, but you need to accept that you're not going to change the framework or you're not going to. So he will define some pieces. Some pieces have to be fixed and probably for 24 months or 36 months. Because for those longer maintenance contracts, for example, a bank mainframe contract is given, when IBM gets a mainframe contract from any telco or bank, it's a 5-year contract in one shot. It's a few million dollars. And there they commit that we are going to commit X resources with X hours and this cannot change. However, they define like these things can change. A fully agile version doesn't work in a lot of scenarios. So there is, I would say, like a hybrid version where you accept these things we accept will be fixed, we commit upfront, and these things we are okay to change. I mean, maybe you can count it that this is agile, but...
No, I wouldn't. But I think you can actually approach that, the outsourcing model in a different way, which is, I want to hire 5 developers, which is actually better. Because how many times have dug behind the curtain of your outsourced firm and found they've been shifting people around behind the scenes?
No!
And you're wondering why the code quality varies so much from week to week.
Absolutely. But there are times when you cannot do that, and when the company would say, I'm taking an accountability, and if the person leaves, does it mean you're not going to pay me? I'm replacing the person. And you say, oh, the next developer you hire, I will interview.
No. You could just say, I want 5 developers of this caliber, and they're dedicated to us. These bodies are dedicated to. I mean, it's saying, I'm going to give you, what you're saying here is, I'm giving you a short-term employment agreement, a fixed employment agreement. But you have to look at it differently. I think one of the things that happens in Agile is that acknowledged uncertainty climbs dramatically. And I underline acknowledged uncertainty. Because the fact of it is, the question I just posed earlier, it's completely uncertain. We don't know what we're going to be doing in 24 months. You know, we don't even know if we're going to have a job in 24 months, okay? That's the reality. But we tend not to acknowledge that. We tend to like pretend that's not true, and we don't talk about that elephant in the room. But when you go to an Agile and you really embrace it, you're acknowledging a level of uncertainty. I mean, I had someone telling me, well, how many tier one features is that team going to deliver in the next 6 months? And I said, define a tier one feature for me. I started pushing them back on an incredible level of uncertainty, because that's the reality.
Yeah, but the challenge comes is, there are times when your partner will say, why should I commit X amount of resources for you if you're gonna just decide to shut down the project in 6 months, and in my country, I cannot fire a person, I have to give a 3-month notice, and this is the problem, right. And you have to give me at least a minimum X amount of commitment. Most outsourcing contracts have a minimum commitment, which is at least 12 to 24 months minimum.
Right, and I have no problem with that. I'm just saying, let's do it up front. Let's be honest about what we're doing. You know, which is, I'm giving you, you know, it's basically what you're saying. So I'm giving you a short-term employment contract of up to 24 months with a notice period of 6 months. I mean, you know, for example, I mean, that's one way to say you're going to structure it. You know, okay. You know, I think what we need to do is say, how do we change the business agreements? I also think that when you outsource work, I've really come to the conclusion that what I want to always see is an RFC, you know, IATF level RFC type document that talks about what is expected in terms of the outward behaviors. But I don't care about if you want to have chipmunks running on treadmills doing it, I don't care. You know, but make sure that, you know, you actually support, you know, dots in people's names.
Okay. So there are effectively a couple of different ways in which you can outsource. One of them could be that you say that this is the project, this is the end outcome I want, go ahead and build it out to these specs. Or alternatively, you can say, this is the caliber of team I want, and I want these many people with me for this long. So if you guys are thinking of outsourcing, explore those two methods.
Singapore startups, that's very crucial, because hiring talent is very, very expensive in Singapore. It's scarce, it's expensive. And if you are trying to build a Southeast Asia product, these guys can speak better, because we accepted the fact that we cannot maintain a development team in Singapore. We cannot find, and we cannot find enough. We outsourced 90% of our development to Vietnam. 90%. We are like only two tech guys left. And that's like, everyone keeps on leaving in Singapore team, so these are the two left. When they leave, then it would be zero. And everyone else is in Vietnam.
Don't tweet this about Lazada, all right?
So a couple of comments there that I was making. First off, we're not talking about expensive headcounts. We'll talk about expensive headcounts in Silicon Valley.
Expensive is relative.
But the other comment. When you outsource, you need to look at the total cost. Okay? I when I'm asked to do tech due diligence for a startup company, and I see that the engineering team is essentially completely outsourced, I raise a red flag. I just raise a major red flag. I say, this is a major risk, and I'll go into why it is a major risk. Because it is. Because the fact of the matter is, I did a tech due diligence recently, and the development team had never met the product people face to face. Okay? It's just ridiculous. I mean, that even if they are quote practicing Agile, they're not. Okay? Because of the level of interaction that's not happening. And that's just a horrible risk. You know, guys, go out. We've got the number 9th CS program in the world here. We've got the number 14th in the world here. We have two fine programs at SMU and SUTD. Go out and reach out to those students. Start working with them now. Start bringing them in. Give them real internships, okay? Trust me, a lot of these people are not going to want to go to the US this coming summer. No, I'm serious. Friend of mine, family, Asian American, their windows were etched with swastikas last week.
Oh, gosh.
Okay? It is scary. I can tell you a lot of stories that I'm hearing from my friends that are just, I'm terrified.
Okay, so moving on to the next agile question, we'll say some stories for later. Nuno, this one's for you, all right? You've been quiet for a while, between these guys.
Yeah, he's here as the buffer between the two pipes. All right,
so
the teacher placement, thank you.
it was thought of. Let's talk about the cons of agile, all right? Nuno, in your view, followed by you guys, are there any functions, organizations, industries, other than the one that you've already mentioned, that should refrain from using Agile and opt for alternative methods?
That feels like a trick question, but I'm going to say no. I honestly don't think so. So if it's not obvious by now, my preferred Agile methodology is Scrum. And if you know anything about Scrum, you know that the founders of that movement have been trying to prove that Scrum is applicable to just about anything you want to do in the world, right? From hospitals to architecture to, I think the only thing they've been staying out of is civil construction. But everything else is fair game. So I haven't found yet a very good example of a place where Agile wouldn't be a positive outcome. Even the ones where the environment is fairly static, like I was speaking of earlier, they don't necessarily get injured as much by using waterfall, but they wouldn't lose anything from using Agile. And especially, there's more value to Agile methodologies than just, you know, speed to market or things like that. There's also, and this often gets sort of lost in the morass of terms between lean and whatnot, but there's this whole concept of waste. And one thing that I learned from my first Scrum trainer, which was super eye-opening, is that these methodologies actually are supposed to reveal dysfunction. And it's not dysfunction just in how you develop software or what. It's dysfunction in the company at large. Because if your software engineering is doing really well and they're following whatever process blindly, and it's going well and they deliver on time, but then the sales team doesn't get training, or the marketing isn't ready, or the finance team doesn't know what the heck's going on. So all of these rhythms and all of these approaches to try and reduce wastage and create more visibility across end up bubbling up in the company. And so I think just on that alone, the usage or application of Agile methods in any company would be positive.
Okay. Warren, your thoughts on the same? Do you think there are any companies that would benefit from not using Agile other than the outsourcing example you already gave? Anything else?
Government tenders. The company, because in those scenarios it's long-term contracts, and so for research grant contracts, those government tender contracts, because the government will give you a contract upfront for those, and the challenge is the tender processes are created in a way that the RFPs will go out and the submission would actually need you to define all the BRDs and those upfront. For example, let's say government of Singapore, for example, is going to launch a satellite system to do $400 million project to do automatic ERP tracking, something like that.
Sure.
And when they do an ERP, they have to give a contract to some company to do it. And at that time, the company cannot say, oh, you give me this $100 million contract and we'll figure it out. So they have to put a stake in the ground that when we deliver in 2020, whosoever company pitches for that contract, you have to tell upfront what are you going to deliver in 2020. You cannot say, yeah, don't worry, trust us, we got it, don't worry.
Can I add on another example just for everyone else out here? Would be, let's take for example shipbuilding, right? When you talk about building up engineering feats mm-hmm. like that, everything needs to be specified down to the T, right? And that's what you're referring to is, when you're talking about the satellites, everything needs to be specific on how you're going to do it.
And unless you do that, and unless you commit to what are you going to do in the next 4 years, you're not going to get the contract. And yes, how do you implement? While implementing, you can do smaller cycles, you can do all of that, sure. But you have to put a stake in the ground upfront 4 years in advance that this is exactly what I'm going to deliver. These are the exact features, these are exact sets. And it's a $200 million contract. You cannot walk up 2 years later, oops, sorry, we didn't think about it. We need another $100 million. You cannot go and go tell that to the government of Singapore.
So I would argue that we're really talking about two very different things here. First off, if a process is defined process, then don't apply Agile to it. Don't apply Scrum. It's for empirical processes. Building a ship is a fairly well understood, you know, repetitive process. One ship, I mean, that's why they have classes of ships. They knock out one after the other on the same plan. You know, it's an Eisenhower class cruiser, aircraft carrier. You know, that's, you know, we, you know, that even with the minor differences between them, they're pretty much the same. So what I would say is what you're talking about on the tender is you're really talking about a frozen story backlog. What you're saying is we're doing the complete backlog for the system, for what we're doing on day one, and we freeze it. And we're saying, and you know what, we can do that. You know why we can do that? Because our customer's not changing the requirements. The market is not changing underneath us. You know, now if they come to us, then we negotiate. And basically what you're saying is, oh, well, you're asking us to break the sprint. You know, so we're gonna terminate the sprint because it was a 24-month, you know, a big long sprint, and we'll terminate it, and we'll take in those requirements, and we'll reforecast everything, and we'll, boom, we'll pick it up from there.
So Jordan, I'm not sure if I heard this right, because maybe I'm just surprised. Do you think in this case it's all right if they don't use Agile if everything's defined?
No. I just said. What is it? Why do we do Agile? Because software is an empirical process. If you're talking about a defined process, which building a ship is, okay?
No, I'm talking about a software system.
No.
I mean, like a defined end output, but needs to be built in a particular way.
It can be for a software system. So when they want a software system to manage or to track. If they want a software system to track every vehicle moving everywhere, so it's a software system. It's not a hardware system. It's a software system. And this software system has to visualize it, generate reports, and they have to define it fully, and it's a $400 million project. So they cannot tell a company to figure it out later.
No, but what I'm going to argue is what you're really saying is you've just built a backlog. You've just built a backlog that is frozen at the beginning of the project.
Yeah.
And then how you break that down, that work, through the course of the project, I don't care how well you design it. You're not going to know how you implement the telemetry handoff in that until you're in there. You know, and you'll probably go down three or four alleys, okay? Which is why a government contract with anything that has a fixed backlog, you know, where you just say, you got to deliver all these stories, these epics and these stories to make it work. It's going to be more expensive because it's going to cost more over the course of the project to do that. Now, I would not say that is not a true waterfall, because a true waterfall says that you've nailed down every requirement, every requirement and everything. You're talking at this point, you're saying, you know, what it would say in a document like this, it would say something like, telemetry will be handed off from cell towers as vehicles move through the grid, you know, in a way such that the interruption in signal is no more than 100 milliseconds. That's just a story. That's just a story. How you do that, that's a whole different thing. You know? Now, if you ask me to try to bid on that and do it all up front, I'm gonna go, God, yeah, five. That'll be $1 billion.
And that's the thing, right? You have to bid on it.
You have to bid, yes.
Otherwise you won't get the business.
Okay, so you know, objective differing opinions audio on this one.
And I'm not done yet.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Well, just to help out and sort of moving away from the software mindset here, just to explain a little bit more what I was trying to say earlier on, I believe that the world at large, all of the economy, all of the consumer perspectives are going to start expecting just-in-time immediate delivery. Okay, so the amount of time that people will have for waiting 24 months, 4 years, for whatever, and your example is actually really good, Varun. I'm not saying this to detract from that. It's just that we're still in transition. We're still transitioning from the old industrial approach of doing things where everything must be defined up front and paid up front, or at least budgeted up front, and then we'll amortize it over years, and we'll slowly see it popping up. I was on my way here. I saw a building down in Marina Bay that I swear to God 3 months ago was not there. All right, and just on that, the Chinese are now building skyscrapers faster than anybody in about 3 months, by the way, because they've apparently mastered a technology for prefabricated buildings. So they prefab every floor, or up to every floor, and then just start layer them on top of it. Now, is it not conceivable that in that sense, you can start with the idea that the building is going to be, you know, 110 stories high, and there's going to be 50 of these and 50 of those. And as you're building it, you go like, you know what? The market's changed. The requirements are different now. We need more, people apartments instead of offices. You know, we need more houses than offices. And they actually are still in time to adjust the configuration, change the assembly line order to say, hey, you know, let's do this a different way. And similar example to the ship. Well, the ship's a little bit more complicated because they build it in in the worst possible way, which is horizontal slices instead of vertical slices, or is it the other way around? Sorry. Yeah. But anyway, so just think a little bit wider than just software. Although most of us probably are here because of the software, that's why I think that the agile approach to this has got a lot of future to it. And just to sort of add a little bit of a, you guys, if you haven't seen it, go look for this video on YouTube, which is about the story of a product manager in the military who was trying to build a tank. Actually, sorry, he's trying
Bradley.
To build...
Bradley.
Yeah, he was trying to build an all-purpose carrier, and the story goes on for about 30 years.
The Bradley fighting vehicle.
Yeah.
FCM.
There's a movie on this.
There's a whole movie on this, and it's hilarious, and it touches on the exact same points that both Varun and Jordan have been talking about. And how there's a fixed contract, and how it's supposed to be a reasonably defined process, but just because of the human intervention in it, it is everything but a defined process. And it's a very funny movie. I recommend it.
Or if you want to see the case that's playing out right now, how about the F-35?
Oh, God.
Multi-purpose fire.
I have a hand in that. Sorry. That's
okay. So here's the interesting thing. So the interesting thing is that the A-10 Warthog,
yeah,
which is the preeminent ground support aircraft in the world, the one that you can basically blow the wings off and it keeps flying.
Literally, not a joke, it's true.
I mean, there are pictures of them coming back from the field where there are holes a meter wide in the wings, and the thing kept flying. So that came out of Lockheed Skunk Works. Lockheed Skunk Works was an agile workshop before we knew what agile was, okay? The F-35 is a classic government waterfall project. And I think the cost per plane is now up to $120 million.
Yeah, you're forgetting the part where the F-35 used to be called the F-22, which they stopped producing because even before it reached their initial production run, it was already like 10 times over budget.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Okay.
Anyway, back to where were we?
the fact of the matter is you can see the difference. And now there's other factors at play here. Other factors that, you know, that he talks about, you know, hey, It shows you the dysfunction of organizations. Well, if there's something that has a dysfunction, it's the U.S. military procurement process. I get to say that. I am still a U.S. citizen.
All right, we're going to get back to Agile now. But good segue from the Lockheed Martin piece. Jordan, let's start with you. Which is an Agile company that you really admire? Can you tell us why?
I'm going to tell you a part of a company that I really admire. And it's my former group at Yahoo, Developer Platforms and Services, DPS. James Collins in Sunny Vale leads it. Fantastic organization that over the course of, James has probably been driving that for about 5 years, went through from a dysfunctional organization that literally could not deliver anything anyhow to the point where more and more responsibility is given to the group because it can deliver. And managing individual scrum teams and scrums of scrums and doing that in an effective way, just a fantastic organization. The impact that it had on how people do performance reviews and management, uses a horizontal management model, many really great things.
Can you just share with everyone here, like perhaps the functionality or whatever you guys created, like the big complicated piece that you guys created?
Well, I'll tell you what I did is I deployed Chef, which you may or may not know, a technology over the entire Yahoo fleet. I can't say how many nodes that is because I'm still under NDA, but you know how many it is.
That's a lot.
It was the biggest Chef deployment in the world.
It's more than 10.
It's more than 10. Even bigger than Facebook's Chef deployment. And so, huge deployment. And we had to basically build a hosted service using their technology. We had to work with somebody external, the vendor we were getting it from, and do all of that. They built the continuous delivery pipelines that are used at Yahoo. Did a lot of work on PaaS, platform as service for Yahoo, as well as infrastructure as service for Yahoo. to improve utilization and such. I mean, just they had their, I mean, it got to the point where James was like saying, no, we're not going to do that because we're not, yes, I know you want us to take it on. Yes, you want us to do this project, but we're not going to do it.
Nuno?
Okay, that actually turns out to be a harder question than I expected. So, I'll, you know, from a company that I've worked with and that I really still admire and think of fondly, the first Agile transition that we did, the one that was actually at Lockheed Martin, because it had all the right elements, so the motivation, the support, basically it went really, really well. We still had some issues, like we had like one of the sprints was a hardening sprint, believe it or not, full on testing. But anyway, those guys, I mean, I was very impressed with what we were able to achieve there. The other company that I can think of that still baffles me to this day is a company that I've worked with, you know, they have Scrum, they do Scrum training and Scrum coaching, Odd-E. And the company is extremely interesting because they have no structure whatsoever. There is some ownership, there is some directorship, but it's mostly from administrative purposes. Everything else that they do is essentially based on agile principles, not necessarily Scrum. And to this day, I still don't understand how they do it. But they keep on, you know, they seem to be very happy. They keep on expanding. They keep on bringing on people. And I think every member of the team is free to do literally whatever they want, as long as it, you know, they believe that it furthers the business. And I just thought that was a beautiful thing because, you know, not every company lets you work that way. There will always be some sort of issue with that.
Awesome. Mark?
For me, I would say one product which I see like every month there is something new coming out is WhatsApp. Okay. Because if I look at what all they have achieved in the last 1 year, from a basic messenger app, they have built something which Skype hasn't been able to build in 10 years. I mean, something as, I mean, video calling in such a simple, easy way, and they started as just a messenger, and then from that on, that's a real approach to Agile. Like every month they're shipping something which is like, in a way, planet changing, with hundreds of millions of users. And at that scale, launching something at that scale is incredible.
That's a great example.
Actually, I want to something like that even more interesting and apropos. So the people who founded WhatsApp were the first former management of DPS at Yahoo. And James Collins actually consulted with them part-time on setting up how they were going to do things. So that what was achieved in that group was nice. Influenced there.
Nice. All right, so we're going to, like, if you guys have any short questions, we can take one now before I get on to my next one. But questions need to be short, all right? 10 seconds or less.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. No, I find it fascinating because in a case that, Varun, you're skeptical about undertaking, which is common, because, you know, when you ask questions for Japan in terms of contactability, whereas, you know, Jordan is positive and looking at it from a tier one. My question is that, Jordan, could you assist us in the context of design thinking and system design in the undertaking engineering, firstly engineering, because subsequently go to marketing, management.
Okay, so design thinking and engineering?
Yeah, that's
okay.
Right.
I'm trying to figure out how to wrap my head around this question real quick. I mean, so again, designing is it's an empirical process. It's an iterative process. It's guided by feedback. So to me, this is a natural fit. Unless I'm missing something.
Yeah.
Am I missing something? Or,
no,
you'll tell me if I am. I know.
I think it basically design thinking is an expression of agility because you're doing exactly what Agile proposes, which is okay, figure out what you think people want, design an experiment that tries to test that hypothesis, and then build upon that. Either you've made it or you haven't, and you have to do another iteration. So
perhaps like Warren and I were sharing earlier, can you share with them the Samsung example where different components are created separately?
So just giving you an example from a Samsung time. So every time a Samsung device has to be shipped, there are two versions. One is a black version and one is a real version. So black version is everything which goes inside the phone, the software side. When they don't know what, how the bezel is going to look like, how rest of the stuff is going to look like, waterproof, no, they don't know. The software team doesn't care about all this.
Is that the same as the breadboard? Like, the, is that the same as the breadboard build that they create for the phone at first?
It's slightly advanced than the breadboard.
Oh, okay.
Build. Right. So it will have the screen and everything, but it will not know the physical attribute. It will not know the features. It will not know the thickness or thickness, shape. It will not know. It will know the software layer. And that device is ready at least 8 months, sometimes even 1 year before. So the software team focuses just on that. And the industrial design team focuses just on the outside of it. They just focuses on the box of it. They don't care what goes inside. And they agree beforehand that these are the broader dimensions mm-hmm. at which we need to converge. Mm-hmm. So it cannot be that one team designs for a 5.5, another team works on 4.5. These are the high level stuff we will agree. And then both sides have to converge at this point. And from this point, like, 6 months before the launch, both sides need to converge, and then we need to iterate. We need, there would be different versions, one with bezel, one with thicker, one with smaller, and then you have to do designs, you have to put it in back pocket and sit for a bend gate, do all that stuff. So that's, again, you can call it design thinking. I mean, the way I look at it, design thinking is another agile. Everyone says they won't do it, they are doing it, doing it. 10% know agile, even bloody maybe 3% know what design thinking is.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so, sorry, go on.
So let's put the term agile away. Let's just put it away. And let's talk about defined versus empirical. Okay? Do you step forward off the line with complete knowledge of where you're going? If you do, then that's defined process. If you don't, then it's an empirical process. Then we need to come up with a set of practices. They talk about it sometimes, ceremony in the world of rituals that guide us through that. And you want those to be as lightweight as possible because you don't want them to be painful to you. So I think that's the thing is, you know, that's why Agile has this, you know, kind of family of practices. Scrum, I think, probably be one of the best and well-formed and most mature. But it's, they're all trying to deal with this fact of dealing with an empirical process. So put Agile aside, ask yourself, are you empirical or not? And the reality is the people in this room, 99% of us are dealing with stuff that's empirical. There's a high level of uncertainty when we come out of the blocks. And then find the set of methodologies, techniques, ceremony, practices that will let you cope with that. That means you need to understand what an empirical process is and what it functions on. And that's, you know, it's about feedback loops.
Okay. So you made a statement right now, like everyone, about design thinking and Agile, which is a lot of people think they're doing Agile, but they're really not. But have you noticed any difference, firstly, between the US and Asia?
So I think that these are very general statements.
Okay,
so it's very, very
okay, it crosses with my next question in case, all right? So which is about how local culture and local cultural norms actually, can they actually have an impact on Agile?
Oh, God, yes. Yes, God, yes. So let's just use the difference between, I'm going to use three zones here. Part of Silicon Valley, okay? So Mountain View, California, which is where I lived. Chicago, Illinois, and Singapore, okay? The amount of direction that people in Silicon Valley, Mountain View will accept, and I underline accept, is asymptotically close to, you know, zero. Okay, you go to Chicago, those guys want a lot more direction. They want a lot more direction, they want a lot more guidance and everything. You come to Singapore, and that level just took another jump.
Yeah.
Things that I would just, you know, kind of historically, you know, when I've talked with people, I've done some conversations, I won't call it consulting, but just, you know, conversations with people. It's like, well, yeah, just let them decide that. I'm like, oh no, we can't. Why? Because they don't want to. I'm like, they want you to make that decision? Really? Okay. The other thing is, I mean, I think that some of the best discussions you have in kind of an agile form, you know, when you're doing empirical, are people really putting it out there, you know, and that level of passion can be perceived as trying to force things. And I'm like, no, I'm just trying to try the idea out. It's destructive testing. I'm trying to take it to the breaking point. And the way it's perceived, as I've gotten feedback from some people, is, oh, well, you're just trying to push people around. And I'm like, no, I'm just trying to see if the idea breaks.
add a Chengdu inside it, and you will find another flavor to it.
Oh, yeah.
Because in that scenario, brainstorming, discussion, opinion, those words do not exist.
Exactly.
And in that scenario, imagine if you have a development team based out of Chengdu, mm-hmm. and working with product managers based out of Valley. That would be the perfect,
perfect storm.
I would love to see you being the product manager with a dev team based out of Chengdu.
Yeah.
Nuno, what about you? We've worked at teams all over the world, I'm sure.
I have seen a bit of everything, actually. So I have to say that, you know, in Singapore specifically, I don't know. I guess people in Asia in general, but Singapore specifically, they tend to not be very outspoken, right? Don't ask too many questions. Just do as you're told, kind of a thing. I mean, sorry, but
general statements.
Yeah, very very general. Very very general. Don't take away my PR. But I've seen that changing though. So I've been in Singapore for, longer than I can remember, 15 years. So I've seen things change so much that nowadays, I see people wanting to take a lot more ownership of the issues, you know, and say, I don't want to just do as I'm told. I want to contribute. I want to be creative. I want to do stuff. I don't want some architect to come in and tell me how to do stuff. I want to do stuff myself, or I want to try my hand at being an architect. But then, you end up having a lot of ego clashes, and that's unfortunate. And maybe that's what you're talking about. I don't know, Jordan, but I think there's a lot of... I think ego clashes when people have a lot of experience and have a lot of know-how are perfectly normal and natural and expected and usually are very healthy. Ego clashes with people who think they know a lot and, you know, let's call them prima donnas, they tend to be very wasteful. And you just go around and around and around in circles and, you know, eventually somebody is going to get upset and leave. So I think my experience directly has been that things have been getting better. Engineers are starting to take a lot more ownership, and not just engineers. But there is still a vacuum when it comes to who makes the final decision. Everything's fine until people start getting upset at each other and say, I don't agree with you, I don't agree with you, and then don't move forward. There has to be somebody who comes in and makes a decision. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is actually a bit of a problem when you're trying to institute this environment of, you know, we're all going to pitch into this and figure it out, and ultimately there still is a bit of that, well, we need somebody to come in here and make the decision because we can't agree. That's where I see things right now.
Thanks. I'm going to open it up again for any more questions. Otherwise, we have one last one. Yeah, go ahead.
Sure. So my question is regarding agile ceremonies. So to what extent, for example, for somebody in a settings of a startup context, to what extent should you follow the ceremonies closely? And for example, because some companies might not want to follow all of the rituals and standoffs very closely because it might not fit what is happening. And for example, what is the metrics or indicators that you need to use to know that whether you're on the right track or whether you need to improve something?
Okay, so I'm just going to repeat the question, which is, to what level should you actually follow all the ceremonies given that you're a startup and you're a lean team? And what metrics are indicators that you're doing it right versus not really doing it well at all?
I'm curious.
Personally, I feel that sometimes a lot of them are management overhead, and
excuse me.
that's where the whole argument started last event, because a lot of times it's more of a lot of people are double hatting a lot of roles. So the product manager is not only the product manager, he's also in charge of marketing, and he's also in charge of meeting the customers. And he's like, dude, it's so straightforward. Can't you just go and do it? And do I need to still write all these, do you want me to be a clerk to write all of this, everything I've explained to you? Can't you just do it? And again, yes, in theory, it's not right. It needs to be fully documented and stuff, but the fact is, you are running towards a line and you have limited funding and you need to ship the product out. And again, it goes probably like a three people garage team, it works. So, and when it's slightly bigger, so the question probably is, at what time does that overhead becomes more valuable than a hassle?
Again, it goes back. Throw Agile out. It's empirical. How are you getting your feedback loops? You know what? Do it in a damn Slack channel. Okay? Just do it in a Slack channel. You don't have to get together physically. Now, you know, perhaps, you know, you want to follow up questions, things like that. But that's what it's about. It's about the feedback loops. Are you having those conversations? Are you demonstrating that you're actually doing things? It's like for the empiricist. I mean, what is a sprint review, a sprint demo? It's saying, I want to really touch that thing. I want to feel that. Does it really exist? That's what you're doing there. Okay? Now, again, if you're a small team, if you're under the one pizza rule, and that's the entire company, you could feed the whole company on a pizza, then, the level of formalized overhead you need is low, as long as you have alternatives. So what's getting that short loop? What's getting that one-day loop? What's getting that slightly larger loop? How are you deciding what you're going to do? The reality is a really, really small team in a startup that is, like pre-seed even, okay, is probably going to be doing a lot of Kanban. Because what's going to happen is, that product manager, cum CEO, cum business development, cum head of marketing, is going to walk in and say, I had this meeting with someone today, and my God, they could give us an incredible deal, and the market opportunity is fantastic. Do you know that there are 5,000 of these in Southeast Asia, and each of them would be willing to pay us $5,000 each? Do you know how much that is? And he's like, and what we want to show him is how we do this. It's like, oh, well, that's the most important thing we're going to be working on. To the top of the backlog. Don't break a sprint. Don't abnormally terminate a sprint is the formal term, to deal with this. Use a different methodology that is empirical. Okay? Like, I would never put a support team on Scrum. I would never.
Yeah.
This way is madness. Okay? I put them on Kanban. Anything that is running a service, I would not put on, on Scrum. I'd use Kanban. But they're both things that acknowledge the empirical nature of the work that they're on.
So, you don't know anything to add?
Just to reiterate what Jordan was saying, and I was thinking what I was going to answer is, a startup's objective is to, as quickly as possible, figure out if their concept is going to have any kind of market traction. So you want the least amount of overhead possible for you to do that. And I agree with Jordan, if you're all sitting in the same room and if everybody's there, you don't need any of those ceremonies and whatnot. They will happen organically, you don't have to worry about that. What you do need though is to know what are we gonna get at first, and with Kanban what helps a lot is knowing how long it takes to get to the point where it's done and ready to be shipped. So then you don't have to worry about sprints and planning and whatnot. You're too small for that. You just keep working until you've got something ready to deliver and ship it and test the market. That's all I have to say.
So one thing that a lot of people practicing an agile methodology miss and forget, and is managing your WIP, your work in progress limit.
It's critical.
It's critical. It's critical, especially for a startup, because really you could be running in 12 different directions, and you want to maintain that. And also, the last comments, always trust the dog.
And don't use Scrum because a lot of people are talking about it. As Jordan said, your team actually may not need Scrum. So Agile is fine, but even in Agile, and if you're not sure, talk to someone who has been doing it for a while on advice of which exact methodology is right at your stage of company. One of them may not be right.
Okay, so we're going to move on to...
Even look at XP, actually, because that was a precursor to a lot of these things. It was just extreme programming. If you're a development house, if you follow the tenets of XP, you won't be far off.
If you're working with customers, you can sit in their laps. If you remember, it was the Ford payroll system.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, they literally moved all the payroll people into the room with them.
Yeah.
They did their jobs day in, day out in that room with the developers.
Okay. So I'm going to move on to our last question, but after that you can get free consultancy from them. And
now they're all met, they're free? All, you told us we could charge.
All
I heard pizza. There was pizza mentioned in here somewhere.
Later on. Okay. Okay, so the last question for you guys is, in your view, what are the first few things that a company should do to embark on an agile journey? Oh. And let's limit it to a maximum of three. So it could just be one, it could be two or three.
Holy crap.
Understand what is the nature of an empirical process. One.
Okay.
That's all.
To me, that's the most important thing.
Wow. Okay. Well, things that have worked in the past is to get management buy-in, because getting things going from the ground up is great, but if you don't have the management convinced, it's going to be very, very difficult. And that was very helpful. Another thing that was helpful, although painful, was that burn your bridges. You don't have a choice. Yeah, commit to it. Seriously. The situation that we were very successful in was kind of like, you know, if we don't change what we're doing, we're all going to get sacked. And that was a very good motivator, believe it or not.
You cannot be a little bit agile or a little bit scrum or a little bit empirical.
I'd say get a buy-in from the team, because you don't want your engineers to feel that suddenly there is a guy who they have to report what they did in last 8 hours every morning. So you need to explain to your team why it is. Respect their feedback. Answer their concerns, and you will have an insane amount of backlash if it's because there's a new cool dude who came from outside and he thinks this is a cool process, and now it's imposed, and the developers now start to hate that this outsider has come to police us, and it has become a police state. So respect your guys.
I've had developer strikes on that point, actually.
show them the benefit of it. So the first time you hear an impediment, through everything you have to clear that before lunch. I mean, it may not be possible, but God, make sure they know about it. You know, and it's like, oh, I'm going off to talk to purchasing right now about those servers. I'll be back, you know, in 2 hours, you know.
Awesome. Well, you know, let's hear it up for these guys. They're all veterans in the field. They're going to be here later, so you can speak to them. Thanks, guys, for this.
Great.
And this is also our last Product Tank for the year. We're going to have one more. We're going to start again in January. There are a bunch of stickers lying out there from Product Tank. Please take one. Don't take them all. And that's about it. Thanks for coming out today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can we have two, please?